welcome to worship this week as we join together in our online community. We're the Lewisport Pastoral Charge, and I'm Reverend Steph, and I'm glad to welcome you to this service. A couple of announcements, just quickly. We have a session meeting coming up on Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock, and if you're on the session for the Lewisport Pastoral Charge, you will get a phone call with all of the call-in details that you need to come online. And we will also have Sunday School Zoom this Sunday at 6 p.m. So if you have young ones who would like to connect with Sunday School in a whole brand new way, you need to let me know so that I can give it to you, because we can't publish it outright for safety reasons. We'd love to have you join us. As I walk through Lewisport or in any of the beautiful walks that I enjoy with Roxy, I have been appreciating the beauty of fall. Remembering the Ecclesiastes passage that says, to everything there's a season and a time to every purpose under the heavens.
It is indeed a season to celebrate as we mark a milestone with Reverend Art Elliott, 55 years of ordination. And we celebrate with Ruth, who has been his ministry partner through all of it. We all have purpose, and Eliana will remind us of that as she lights our Christ candle today.
Jesus bids us shine.
Into worship to do just that. Please join me in the call to worship, which you'll see on the screen. We gather as God's beloved children. However glad we are, however out of sorts we are, we come together as a people whom Jesus calls into community. So this becomes a place where all are welcome. We've come to give thanks, to pray and sing, to be with each other. So let us worship God. As an opening prayer, I found this almost creed. It's inspired by Psalm 20, and it's a beautiful passage of poetry and reflection that I think opens our hearts and our minds to the topics of the day and helps us to place ourselves into worship with God and with each other. It's responsive as well. So you can join in with me. Do we believe? Yes, in spite of ourselves, we do believe. While some follow fad and fashion, changing with the seasons in Paris, London, and New York, we follow the man from Nazareth. While some put their hope in a big lotto win or chase profits at no matter what cost to family, we put our hope in loving one another as Christ has loved us. While some may give in to sophisticated cynicism, or some fall into apathy or despair, we put our faith in God, who has given us his only true Son. While some may boast of their superior education, culture, race, or living standard, we boast in the self-giving of that Son on a cross. While some try to justify themselves by prizing fame or power, or by claiming superior morals, we allow the grace of our Lord Jesus to be our best prize. Because of Jesus, yes, we believe in the living God, by whose Holy Spirit all things are open to change and renewal. And that includes us and the church. Thanks be to God.
Which the morning star began. God.
we place our life in the realm of faith, as we look to the Spirit to give forgiveness and love and comfort to us along the journey of faith, we come to our prayer of confession, knowing that though we believe the things that we've just talked about, we also get caught up in the worldly things that we've denounced. We try so hard to follow Christ, but we still mess up along the way. And so we have our prayer of confession, a chance to recognize that Jesus is the only perfect one amongst us. We're able to concentrate on the things that we need to fix or the things we need to confess so that God can fix them in us. We can confess because we know that God already loves us and has forgiven us. Let's take time to clear our hearts and minds of the things that hold us back so that we can run this race of faith unencumbered. Let us pray. Where we are guided by prejudice, fill us with love. Where we're guided by gloom, fill us with joy. Where we're guided by confusion, fill us with peace. Where we're guided by shallow, quick fixes, fill us with patience. Where we are guided by self-interest, fill us with kindness. Where we're guided by unconcern, fill us with goodness. Where we're guided by convenience, fill us with faithfulness. Where we are guided by smugness, fill us with gentleness. Where we are guided by temptation, fill us with self-control. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us. Come, Holy Breath, live in us. Come, Holy Wind, move through us. And stir up the gifts of your Spirit. Amen. It's not an easy road to travel when we're seeking to follow the way of Christ, but it's an important road. It's important to live outside of ourselves and focus outside of ourselves so that we can, with Christ, offer wholeness to the world. In order to offer that gift to those we come in contact with, we recognize deeply within ourselves the wholeness that Christ gives us. Live freely, wholly, and fully in Christ. Amen. Our Sunday school got together this week. We got together on the steps at the church because we were asked to sign Halle, Halle, Halle for the World Day of Prayer service that's coming up this year. It's not until March, but we're doing an online service this year because so many places are experiencing a second wave of COVID. We're not sure what will happen by March, whether groups will be able to gather. And so we're doing an online service so that we can together worship across the country. And so we have participants from across the country who are leading different parts of the online service for World Day of Prayer, which is using the service provided by the Women of Vanuatu this year. So we were asked, our Sunday school kids were asked if they would do Halle, Halle, Halle in sign language for the addition into that service to show an embodiment and enthusiasm for worship and to bring a child's focus of joy into that service. So with our kids, let's sing and sign together, Halle, Halle, Halle. Responsive psalm is Psalm 1. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way the sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction.
Fully alive in your spirit, Lord, make me fully
passage. We're still in Matthew 22, a section of scripture where the Pharisees continue to test Jesus and his authority and teaching. Matthew 22, starting at verse 34. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, what do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? The son of David, they replied. He said to them, how is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If David calls him Lord, How can he be his son? No one could say a word in reply. And from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There's a riddle that many children can answer, but it stumps adults. It goes like this. What is greater than God, more evil than the devil? The poor have it, the rich need it, and if you eat it, you die. Try it again. Give you a minute just to think. It's a riddle. Gets us thinking. See if we can trick each other with our cleverness. Have you got it? The answer is nothing. We like riddles. We like to play games with our mind and stretch our brains. We like to see if we can trick each other with our challenging thoughts. In our passage today from the Gospel, we see the Pharisees coming at Jesus again with another riddle of sorts. The Pharisees asked questions to trick Jesus, to trip him up, to try and prove he wasn't who he said he was. They used riddles to try and get the last word so that they could be smarter and show themselves wiser than this new upstart rabbi. And yet, Jesus wasn't fooled. Jesus didn't get stumped on the riddles. In fact, he had already silenced the Sadducees, who were also people who studied scripture, who questioned Jesus's work, his miracles, his healings, his parables, his mission. The Sadducees were silenced. The Pharisees thought they'd come at him one more time and see if they could trip him up. And rather than just challenge him outright, they would try to find questions that were difficult. Questions that would stump the masses that Jesus was speaking to. When they asked Jesus what the greatest commandment was, they knew that the Shema, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and soul, was the greatest, the oldest, and the most important commandment from Jewish scriptures. They knew that it was important to recognize who God was as one being. And they knew that it took our whole lives to live out the love of God. And so when they questioned Jesus about what the greatest commandment was, he wasn't stumped for a moment. He said the Shema, the greatest commandment. He pointed out that the most important thing that we can do is to love God with all of our being. All of who we are and what we have goes into loving God. That's the first thing that Jesus answered. And without a hesitation, he quoted the second greatest commandment and told us that we needed to love our neighbors as ourselves. A commandment that reminded us that if we love God, then we will also love the people of God. In the Jewish faith, the Shema, the call to love God with all of whom we are, is repeated daily by followers of the Jewish religion. It's foundational to how they live and act in the world. There are laws just for the Shema itself. There are laws set for how you speak the Shema, that important foundational knowledge and theology of the Jewish faith. When they looked at that passage of scripture from the Torah, the old part of the Old Testament, they would see the path forward for life. They were called to recite the Shema every day. But before they could do that, they had to spend time in reflection on how they would fulfill it. You see, love isn't just a sentimental feeling. Love is a verb. We love God. God loves us, and we love our neighbors. It's not something we pay lip service to, nice words that we say to throw in a few bits of kindness into this world of turmoil. No, these are words that are clear statements of how we are to live out the love of God and our neighbor. So when the Pharisees tried to trick Jesus, they were stumped yet again, because he went back to the most important things that he would know as a teacher, and he would teach his followers as a rabbi. And then he added to that lesson, as he so often did. Jesus answered their question, and then turned it around and asked them one. When he asked, "Who is the Christ?" Jesus wasn't simply asking a question, a riddle, something to try and trick the Pharisees. Instead, he asked a foundational question of who Christ is. They who were the scholars of the time ought to be able to answer the questions that Jesus had for them. And so he asked them, "Who is the Christ? What does it mean to you?" And he went on to use some scripture to expand the question. Was the Christ the son of David? What did it really mean to be the son of David? The question really was encouraging the Pharisees to think about who the Christ was as they recognized together that they were being asked a question that was difficult. The Pharisees began to be silenced, just like the Sadducees before them, because no one wants to look like a fool. Jesus wasn't trying to trick the Pharisees. He wasn't asking a riddle to show them that he's more clever than they are. Instead, Jesus was asking a question that was central to who they thought he was and what it meant for him to be a teacher, for him to be the Son of God, the Christ. He was asking them a question that meant a life change, a perspective change, a theological change in the hearts and minds of the Pharisees. For if they knew who the Christ was, they would have to wrestle with how to worship and learn from Christ. We do too. That's why the commandment is given that we should love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. Jesus wasn't ever with parables trying to trick us so that we would fall away or be embarrassed about whether we knew the answers or not. Jesus wanted us to learn and grow in faith. Jesus wanted us to know more about God and God's kingdom. And in that knowledge grow in faith and love towards our neighbors and ourselves as the children of God. He was asserting his authority as a teacher and as the Christ when he asked the question about who the Christ really is. If we look at the first part, the greatest commandment, where we love God first with all of whom we are and all of what we have to offer, we recognize a huge calling. Over COVID, it's been a wonderful pleasure of mine to be in contact with a church in the Philippines. This small church had just begun to meet before COVID-19 put a halt to the world's plans. The pandemic affected the entire globe, and this small church in the Philippines was only getting started. During one of our very first online services on Facebook, there was a message sent by a Pastor Jaker. You may have seen his comments if you looked through the comments on our Facebook page. He was very encouraged and enthusiastic about the worship that we were offering online. And then later, when we stopped doing the live stream on Facebook and went to YouTube, I got a comment from him. He was a little bit anxious because he was having a harder time getting our services in Philippines. So he was looking to connect and to be fed by the word that we shared online, but he couldn't get the bandwidth to download the whole service from YouTube. And I spoke with him and we shared some prayers on Facebook. As I talked with him, I learned that he was brand new out of seminary just before COVID. He had just been sent to this very small church that was just starting up. When he found us online, he began to show our services to that small church to help them with messages of hope and love. Whether we knew it or not, our worship, our love of God, our need to gather, even if it was online, was so necessary for us, but also so life-giving to a small congregation in the Philippines. We became sister churches because they shared our services with us, and he'd play them on his phone as the little church gathered around. What an amazing picture that shows when we look at the two commandments given by Jesus: love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. There's a story of a man who lived in a house. The front window of this house was half blocked by a great big boulder that sat out in his front yard. It was too big to move, and so it sat there day after day, year after year, until he was so frustrated that he decided to do something. So he'd go out and he'd take his hammer and his chisel and he'd work away on the rock. And after working for a very long time, he was happy with his work. The neighbors came over to see what he'd done. And taking that big rock that was an obstruction and a bother to him, he chiseled it away until a beautiful elephant was carved from the rock itself. The neighbors were amazed. They had no idea that he was such an amazing carver. They didn't know he had those skills, and frankly, he didn't either. When they asked him how he was able to create such a marvelous, detailed, lifelike statue of an elephant, they asked him how he did it. And his response was that he chipped away anything that didn't look like an elephant. The big rock was transformed. The same way that we can be when we let God chip away at anything in us that doesn't look like love. The story is a beautiful picture for us. When our troubles seem too big, when the world's troubles seem way out of our league, we can't help, and we sometimes get overwhelmed by the size of the obstructions that we face. Instead of giving up, we can see Christ chiseling away all the stuff that doesn't look like love in our hearts and in our lives. And that'll give us an opportunity to shine forth the reality and the beauty of living as one who loves and worships God. As we grow through the lessons that Christ teaches, we're not just taught how to be clever and how to play mind games. We're taught the truths of life that make a difference in how we live and how we love and how God loves through us to make a difference in the world. Whether grief is overwhelming or whether COVID-19 has us stymied. We are a people who know the truths of God's love. We know who Jesus is, and we work to be the likeness of Christ in the world. As we speak the most basic truth of Scripture, the greatest commandment, may we, like our brothers and sisters in the Jewish faith, consider not only the words of the Scripture that Jesus speaks of today, may we also think of how we will fulfill those words. Yes, we're called to love God, but it's a verb. It's an action word. And the small actions that we take, they don't get lost in the big sea of problems that we face. Instead, we chip away a little bit more at each of the obstructions in the path. And each day, as we seek to love God actively, as we seek to love our neighbors with the same amount of respect and equality that we know for ourselves and our loved ones, we too will become the beautiful, righteous people of God, doing justice, loving God, and celebrating the Christ in our midst. May it be so. As we gather our thoughts and our prayers, as we think about the things that we want to offer gratitude for, we come to our pumpkin, our Thanksgiving pumpkin, reminding us that we have many things to be grateful for. Our Sunday school has led us in this pumpkin, and it will make a great thank-o-lantern for Halloween. But we've started at the beginning of October to list some of our thanks on this pumpkin, and so we have some new things from Sunday. Folks have written comments on the Facebook page, so I've included as many things on here as people have mentioned for giving thanks. So there are many giving thanks for these online services and this community that we've built together. One of the children was grateful for outside birthday parties. They've been missing all the birthday parties they usually get to go to, and it was a beautiful day and they had an outside birthday party so that they could be celebrating but also safe. We are thankful for our pets and the ones we get to pet sit. When others go away, we get to take care of them and have them with us. So pet sitting is something we're thankful for. We have certainly been thankful for the weather and our family in Alberta was grateful for a trip to Drumheller to see the dinosaur park and the dinosaur museum in Drumheller, Alberta. Canlin's thankful for a ride on a Harley-Davidson, and someone wrote on the Facebook page that they're thankful for saving grace. And so we have many things to come before God with as we make our offering. We come with a grateful heart, recognizing the gifts that God has already given, recognizing that we are indeed blessed, and that as God blesses us, we also bless God. So as we love God and love others, we make our gifts. Whether we do that by dropping off our envelopes at the church on Mondays, whether we do that through e-transfers or Canada Helps, or by being on par, any of the ways that we make our gifts, we do it with a generous heart, remembering our neighbors who need to know God's love and provision at this time. We are indeed grateful people. And so we pray. For the blessing of this and all our days, we thank you, gracious God. Accept, we pray, not just our money, but also our lives freely offered in gratitude for all that you have done for us. Use them both in this place and wherever you might take us. Amen. Our prayers continue.
Loving God, so often when we look at the problems of the world or even in our own lives, they distract us and overwhelm us. Help us to remember that if we focus on you instead of the problems can be put in perspective, and so will the actions be that we can take to deal with them. God, as we learn to love as an action word, with your help, we can chip away at injustice and hate to show more beauty and compassion in the world. When life's trials loom large and all-encompassing in our lives, remind us to chip away faithfully in love, to reduce them in size, so we can manage your work as we love and worship you with all that we have and all that we are. As we chip away at the problems, help us to find the beauty and the possibilities and the options that we can take as we love and serve you and your people. For God, we are part of your kingdom, and we desire to be kingdom builders with you. A peaceable kingdom of shalom, a peaceable kingdom in which all can live rich lives, full and peaceful, with wholeness and joy. God, help us to focus on you so that when we look at you with all of our heart and our mind and our strength, we know where our true abilities lie. For God, you're able to help us in all ways. to chip away at problems and work to make a beautiful world. And we're thankful for that as you build your kingdom here on earth, just like the one in heaven.
We gather all these prayers into the prayers that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Season of autumn. In nature, we see the beauty of our lives shared with the Creator. Go into the world looking for goodness and hope and peace that you can share with those around you and that can build your spirit so that as the people of God, we can love God and love our neighbors with purpose and with presence. As we go into the world, may we know that God loves us and gives us encouragement and challenge, prompting us to new lessons of how to be love in the world. Go letting Christ chip away at anything that doesn't look like love in your life, so that we can all begin to look more like Christ each and every day. Amen.